If you appreciate our content, please click the thumbs up button and subscribe to our channel. That will really help us to reach more people. Thank you.
All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Center. We're going to start out with My Soul is Welcome Here by Daniel Namod. So I invite you to stand up and sing along. Here we go. One, two, three, four.
I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I'm just where I'm supposed to be.
Repeat that.
I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here.
I'm in the right place.
I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here.
Oh, my soul is welcome here right now.
Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. I am getting the message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here.
Thank you. You can have a seat. Thank you.
Good morning. Well, we may be a little damp today, but we're welcome here. Let's welcome Reverend Gordon Kyler.
Good morning, Unity. And good morning to all of you out there. Mark is excited today. And good morning to all of you out there in Facebook world, whose names I cannot see, but I know you're out there. You were on here a second ago. And we're glad you are here with us today, whether you are in person here in the sanctuary or with us in our virtual world. And if you're coming in just a little late, there's lots of seating on this side of the room, too. Is there anybody here for the very first time that wants to raise your hand if you're comfortable doing that so we can welcome you? Good morning. Yes. We are glad you are here, and we want you to know that we see you. We see your hopes. We see your dreams. We see your struggles. But most of all, we see your light. And whatever brought you here today, whether you are looking for something new to learn, a new way of understanding your own spiritual path, healing, community, whatever it is, we know and we pray that you will find it here today. And if I don't get to say, I know I'll get to say hello to you all. If I don't get to say hello to you before the end of the service, please make sure we connect at the very end of service. I'll be standing in the back. Oh, so before I do this, let's check in on our social media. Please pull out your phones if you use social media and check in on Facebook, Instagram, whatever you use, with our affirmation today, looking on the bright side of life. And some of you may be saying to yourself, there's a song that goes something like that. Yes, there is. And Bill's going to lead us in a Unity rendition of it a little later. I'm excited, can you tell? Any Monty Python fans out there? A couple, yeah. Well, we'll have fun. All right, now it is my pleasure to introduce three very special guests, Nikki Nguyen, Brooke Nutting, and Danielle Slupeski. I can say it. Would you please come up? Nikki, Danielle, and Brooke will be facilitating our workshop after the service today. They are professional death doulas, and I'm sure if you don't know what that is, they're going to tell you right now.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming today, and we look forward for all of you to stay after this and listen to our conversation that we're going to be having. Death doulas are a non-medical, holistic approach to end of life. We help guide families and loved ones and the dying person through the process of death. We're going to share all of the things that are out there around it and hopefully demystify a lot of the questions that you might have. Thank you again for having us.
Did you guys want to say anything? Either one of you?
I'm Danielle Slupeski. I do just want to throw out there that we'd like it to be interactive. We have a couple of hours of time set aside, so we'll have everybody gathering kind of closely, and we don't want this to just be us up here presenting to you all. We want it to be a back and forth. So please join us. It won't be scary, we promise.
All right, thank you, thank you. And the workshop will be starting at 12 o'clock, so you'll have enough time to go back, get a cup of coffee, grab something to eat if you want, and then we'll meet back in here at noon. And now I'll turn the platform over to Martine, who will share some information with us.
So yes, our workshop today, Death is Not a Dirty Word, is going to be right here in the sanctuary at 12 until 2. We have a new online class coming up with Reverend Geo Downer, 5 Basic Unity Principles, or Pentameras Precepts. Okay, thank you, Geo, for giving us that word to deal with. This starts on November 3rd, and it's 6:30 to 8:30. It will be an online-only class. 5 ideas are foundational to unity, as you probably know, and these ideas were variously formulated scripturally, spiritually, and practically. In this class, you can explore, enrich, and experience the 5 basic unity principles. Rather than simply restating or memorizing, we'll interact, interpret, and involve ourselves in an unexpected depth and breadth. This is an interactive, fun class for all, and you can contact the office or go online to our website for more information. Sunday, October 27th, Trunk or Treat and Halloween Carnival. The carnival is going to be part of what the YOU will be doing during the service, and Trunk or Treat is afterwards from noon to 1:30 in the west parking lot, so that area will be blocked off unless you have a trunk load of candy that you're going to be sharing. If you would like any more information, you can get Barbara Billibrand's information by emailing or calling the office if you would like to be one of the participating vehicles and sugar providers. Participating vehicles are encouraged to decorate their cars or trucks and provide treats. Tapping for Health and Wellness, which is usually held this Sunday, will return in November, on November 17th. And there's lots more going on. You can go to our website, our Facebook page, or if need be, call the office, or actually open and read your weekly email and get lots of info. And that website again is uscabq.org. Okay, let's introduce the team today. We have our trustee of the day, Janet Harula, our board president, and I'm Martine Bachman, I'm your platform host. And prayer chaplains today are Josie Godfrey and Susie Orchard. And they will be available for you for one-to-one prayer on either side of the sanctuary this morning after the service, if you would like to take advantage of that. And there are also prayer request slips in the pockets in front of your chairs if you would like to have the prayer chaplains pray for yourself or someone else. Please make sure to include the name, putting my son or something, kind of, I don't know, it's nice to have it focused on a person's name. So include their names and we will pray for that person for a month. Todd Lowry is our music director. And he leads the Unity Soulshine Band, which today is comprised of Todd and Brian Griesmeyer on guitar. Sharon is on vacation.
We'll
in
be back
Portugal.
To full strength next week for some Halloween music.
Okay, cool. And our soloist today, Bill Brooks. And we want to thank our AVLM team, Elizabeth, Austin, Ellen, and Sal. Thank you all. All right, come on up, Janet.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see everybody. And I drove up to Pecos yesterday, and it was absolutely beautiful. Even though it rained, we never got out of the vehicle, and it was great. We live in a beautiful state. So at this point, please join me in reciting our mission, vision, and core values. Our vision: centered in love, we see our harmonious world of divine expression. Our mission: we inspire spiritual growth through honoring many paths, education, prayer, sacred service, and abundant living. Our core values: we are Christ-centered, loving, inclusive, joyous, uplifting, open-minded, and fun. And our unity credo: we believe all people are created with sacred worth. We serve all people in emotional and spiritual ways. We welcome the diversity of all. God and unity leave no one out. This is the part of the service where we give our tithes, our love offerings, and our donations, and there are several ways to do that. You can do it here in person during the Sunday service, and the ushers will come forward to collect that. Our Church Center app, which is what I personally use to donate to the church. You can go online at uscabq.org/give, and we even have a phone text to give at 84321. Please join me in reciting our offering blessing. Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive.
People get ready, there's a train a-coming. You don't need no baggage, you just get on board. All you need is faith to hear the diesels humming. Don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord. People get ready, there's a train to Jordan, picking up passengers from coast to coast. Faith is key, open the doors and board them. There's hope for all among the most. Thank you. I'm getting ready. I'm getting ready. I'm getting ready. This time I'm ready.
Thank you.
Thank you, music team. Please join me in reciting our prosperity dedication. In a universe overflowing with the allness of God, all the needs and desires of Unity Spiritual Center and those we serve are bountifully met. From every direction, known and unknown, expected and unexpected, our abundant good is here now. Thank you, God.
All right, it's time for a congregational song. So I invite you to stand up. We're going to sing A Light in This World, otherwise known as I Am a Light. We know this one. One more time. Here we go.
I am a light, I am a light, I am a light in this world.
The word of the day is loving. I am loving. In Charles Fillmore's Jesus Christ Heals, page 29, we learn God is love, that from which all loving springs. In Myrtle Fillmore's Healing Letters, page 37, we learn that God is love. We make divine love into loving. To be loving means to be kind, understanding, and generous. It means forgiving grievances easily and seeking to understand myself and others. In wanting to be loving toward others, I begin with myself, exercising self-compassion and grace when I make a mistake, making forgiving others easier. Investing time for self-care makes it more natural for me to be a nurturing presence for others. Treating myself well helps make my generosity and benevolence spontaneous and frequent. My divinity is love. My humanity is loving. My loving nature is positive, optimistic, hopeful, and faithful. I am loving.
And in this consciousness of love, we bring to mind all of the things we love. Family, friends, hobbies, careers, the beauty of the place we live, and the cycles of life. As we breathe in that beautiful fall air, turning within, we become one mind, one energy, one life, one voice. Breathing, I see the world around me changing, leaves gradually turning to golden yellow, flocks of birds heading north and geese, cranes heading south. The cooler nights and days. I behold the cycles of life, the coming and the going, and all that lies in between. And I am reminded that all the events, all of the cycles, are but a part of endless life, but a part of new experiences, embracing and letting go, traveling a journey that never ends, that leads to higher and higher views, higher vibrations, that leads ever upward to more beauty, more understanding, and more light. How blessed I am to be on this journey of continuous unfoldment. This journey of evolution. I think about all the paths that I've walked in this life, perhaps in lives before that I could recall, and wonder what lies ahead, what glorious adventures, what new relationships, what new realizations. And what finer expressions. For I am evolving. I have always been evolving. I always will evolve. I recall the words of Jesus who said, "You are the light of the world." And the nature of light is to shine endlessly. And right now, right here, I shine to my fullest, brighter than ever before. I shine my love, my wisdom, my joy, my life, and my light. And as I shine, I feel the warmth from the lights around me. For every living thing has light. And I am but a piece of an endless spectrum, made up of every color possibly imaginable, every vibration, every frequency. In the light, I am filled with energy, filled with health, filled with vitality, and filled with life. In silent wonder, I rest, absorbing light and giving light forth in glorious silence. I feel the vibration of light. Every cell of my being glows and grows. I am a light being. And in this light, I know that there is quite enough love and quite enough power, and quite enough light for all the world in this very room.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for all the world. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all the world, and there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Spirit, God's Spirit, is in this very room.
Bill Brooks is here today with a, you'll have to wait for that other song, this one is a really great song. It's called Live Like You Were Dying. Who did this?
Tim McGraw.
Yeah, it's a really great song.
He said I was in my early 40s with a lot of life before me when a moment came that stopped me on a dime. I spent most of the next days looking at the x-rays and talking about the options and talking about sweet time. I asked him when it sank in that this might really be the real end. How's it hit you when you get that kind of news? Man, what'd you do? And he said, I went skydiving. I went Rocky Mountain climbing. I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. And I loved deeper and I spoke sweeter and I gave forgiveness I'd been denying. And he said, someday I hope you get the chance to live like you were dying. He said I was finally the husband that most of the time I wasn't, and I became a friend would like to have. And all of a sudden going fishing wasn't such an imposition, and I went 3 times that year I lost my dad. I finally read the good book and I took a good long hard look at what I'd do if I could do it all again. And then I went skydiving, I went Rocky Mountain climbing, I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu, and I loved deeper and I spoke sweeter and I gave forgiveness I'd been denying. And he said, someday I hope you get the chance to live like you were dying. Like tomorrow was a gift and you got eternity to think about what you do with it. And what did you do with it? What did I do with it? What would I do with it? Skydiving, I went Rocky Mountain climbing, I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu, and I loved deeper and I spoke sweeter and I watched an eagle as it was flying. And he said, someday I hope you get the chance to live like you were dying, to live like you were dying, to live like you were dying, to live like you were dying.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Bill. Yes. And Brian and Todd, soul shine. I love saying that. Well, Tim McGraw and I have a few differences. I have no desire in my life to go skydiving or ride a bull. But beyond that, it's a great and wonderful song that asks, what would you do? How would you live if you knew we were dying? And what is this thing we call death and dying? You know, as a minister, I deal with that a lot with people. I officiated all kinds of services, and many of the funerals and celebrations of life that I do are actually outside of this congregation because I'm on call at different funeral homes around town. There's a lot of people who don't have ministers, or for one reason or another, a minister won't do their service. But I will, because we... Unity in God, do what? Leave no one out. But one of the things I have noticed through the years of doing this kind of work is that we don't handle this transition that we call death very well. We don't really fully understand it. And I think there's a lot of reasons, which I'll touch on why that is. And maybe today we can come into a better understanding of that. One of the things I've looked at through the years is we get all excited with birth. We have birth doulas. We get ready. We have the room ready. The family gets excited, usually. But what about the other end? Which I believe truly is a birth to something different. Because we know that this thing that we occupy, this avatar, this vessel, is exactly that. And it does eventually wear out. I know I don't want to go through all eternity with this one. I like it for what it's doing right now. It's a great vehicle and vessel. I appreciate it. But there will come a day when I'll go, gee, can we do something, a better model maybe? The other thing that has become apparent to me is what happens when we don't prepare. What happens to our loved ones that are left, what they have to go through. I mean, for us, it's easy. But for those who are left, it's hard. I'm sure that many of you have probably been in that position and would certainly never wish that on your family. So we have to be honest. We're not getting out of this. It just ain't going to happen. I think I heard Elvis Presley say one time, we're not getting out of this alive, folks. But what do we do with this? What do we do with this? How do we make this transition with grace and ease and maybe even with a sense of expectation and with preparedness? How do we make it sure that our families don't have to go through the preparations, the legalities, the property, and all of that stuff along with their grieving? Well, one of the ways we can do that is attending our workshop today, in which our death doulas will be explaining what they do, because I mentioned birth doulas. I didn't know until a few months ago that there were death doulas till I met Nikki. And go, wow, that's a neat idea. Why didn't I think of that? Could have been a whole new career. No, I like this one. But what is death? Perhaps the best thing, the first place we can start, is begin to understand this thing that we call death. And what happens after we leave this earthly vessel? Well, the good news and the bad news is Unity has no set dogma on this. We concern ourselves with what? How we live life here and now. And indeed, even the Jews of Jesus' time concerned themselves with how they lived life now. The truth is, nobody knows what happens beyond this life. Oh, I know. The Bible says this. Well, as those of you who are taking the Bible class know that it doesn't say what it said originally. And ideas have changed throughout history. Philosophies have changed. Religions have changed. Nobody really knows. I can say that most New Thought people, which is us, Unity and all the other New Thought movements, and many other dominant religions around the world, believe in some form of reincarnation. I do. You don't have to. You believe what you want. Certainly Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, our co-founders, did. And interestingly enough, in the original Gospels, before they got translated and retranslated and retranslated down through the ages, there were references to reincarnation in it. Most of the scriptures referred to that in the beginning, and a lot of that was taken out down through the centuries, but a few little tantalizing hints have survived. And one of them is found in John chapter 9 when Jesus heals the blind man, and his disciples say to him, "Teacher, whose sin caused this man to be born blind? His own sin or his parents' sin?" Now notice something there. He was born blind. What does that imply? Well, that implies that they believe he must have had some sort of previous life where he could have sinned, right? Who knows? But the point is, Jesus said, sin has nothing to do with this. That's he didn't use the words, but he probably said that was physiological or genetic or something like that. and it was also a consciousness. But my point is, we need to shift how we look at this. If we look at death through the lens of unity, through metaphysics, through new thought, and even through historical ideas, we begin to see different perspectives on this thing, this transition that we all go through. So perspective number, that's almost as hard to say as that word Gio came up with. number one is transition of the spirit from physical to spiritual. You know, in unity, death is often described as the shedding of the physical body, much like discarding an old garment. The spirit, which we know is eternal, or at least we believe that, continues its journey in a higher realm. Charles Fillmore, the co-founder of Unity, wrote this in his book, Keep a True Lent. The soul is not limited by the body, for it exists in the fourth dimension, or the kingdom of ideas. And the kingdom of ideas are limitless and eternal. In this view, then, death is not an end, but it's a liberation into a more expansive divine consciousness. As I said at the beginning, the body is a temporary vessel, while the spirit is eternal. Myrtle Fillmore expanded on that a little bit and added this: life is not confined to the physical body. When we realize this, we lose all fear of death and are prepared to step confidently into whatever lies ahead. That was from her healing letters. And I wondered, well, if we believe that, if the ancient people, the people of Jesus' time, at least the Jews, believed it, not so much the Romans and the Greeks, where did we get off track? Where did we get into this great fear we have around this? And as I studied and as I questioned, I began to realize it may be the very roots of the Abrahamic faith. The Abrahamic faith, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. All of the three religions that came out of the lineage of Abraham. And they all incorporated a Greek idea of a heaven and a hell. A place where you go if you're good, if you're perfect, if you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That would come later in history. Things like that. Or the other place, you know, where it's hot. Depending on what culture you're from. For Norwegian people, it was frozen. For Polynesian people, it was water. For desert people, it was hot. But there's no basis for that in true Western scripture. Believe it or not, about the 7th century, there wasn't a pervasive idea in early Christianity about that. They simply did not put the emphasis on the afterlife. And so they didn't fear it. And of course, I believe a lot of that grew out of the need to control the masses and empires and kingdoms and things like that, and using religion as the tool to do that. But when we can begin to stress the essence of the idea that we are limitless beings, that our path is ever upward, ever more glorious, ever more expressive, we can begin to change our consciousness around it. And we begin to see it's a beautiful transition into a new expression of life. Which brings us to another perspective. There, I said it. That we come back into unity with God, a return to divine consciousness. Now, I will preface what I'm about to say by this, that there is never a time when we are not in unity with God. We are God expressing. Every human being that has ever lived and ever will live, indeed, all of creation is God expressing. So there is no time, no experience where we're ever separate. There are times when we forget that we are. And so death is seen in this perspective as a return to the source, a reconnection. Unity metaphysics teaches that the soul is an expression of God. And through death, we return to the divine source, completing the circle of life. Charles Fillmore described it this way: life is but the outer expression of an inner invisible force, which is forever one with the infinite source of all that is. In death, the soul reunites with all that is. Not as an escape from the world, but as a continuation of the journey we're on right now. And yes, we may have different experiences going forward. There may be more peace. There may be serenity. But above all, there will be a clearer consciousness of oneness. The good news is we don't have to wait till we're dead for that. We can have that consciousness right here and right now. I like what Eric Butterworth wrote. Death is a door, not a wall. Life continues because life is God and God is infinite. You cannot be separated from God because you are God expressing. Ooh, boy, that'll get you in trouble in some circles. But it's the truth. We are all God expressing. And that metaphor of death as a door rather than a wall emphasizes that idea that death is merely a passage to a spiritual realm where our connection is more fully realized than it is now. Which brings us to the next perspective. Life is eternal, and death is but a transformative experience in life. I love what I heard a Unity minister say one time. It's a graduation to the next realm. It means you have accomplished everything you came here right now to accomplish. It's like graduating high school without the prom. But I think there's a homecoming. Unity teaches that life is eternal, and thus death is but a transformative experience within life, just as birth is, just as graduation is, just as getting married is. It's not an end, it's simply a change of form. To quote Charles Fillmore again, he said, man is, I'm quoting like he said it 100 years ago, folks, man is an eternal being, a son of the infinite. He cannot die, for he is life itself, the immortal expression of the living God. We are all of us, man and woman, child and adult, immortal expressions of a living God. So here Fillmore speaks of the eternal nature of humanity, that we are rooted in the divine, having a human experience. Therefore, we do not fear death. We see it as part of our journey. Martha Smock, a Unity minister, reinforced this with, life goes on. It is continuous and eternal. And each one of us is an inseparable part of life, all the time, for eternity. So again, it is a shift. It is not an end. It's not even a beginning. It's a shift in the moment. It's a shift in experiences. Our true nature is spiritual. And there's also a healing perspective in this. Because we see it as a part of the natural rhythm of life, we see it that is part of the transformation of the physical. It's a transformative and healing force. Ella Pomeroy wrote, there is no death, only change of form. And in that change, we move closer to the realization of our divine spirit. She assures us that death is part of the soul's progression towards its highest spiritual expression. And when we recognize that this is all one big experience, part of one cycle, we release fear and embrace it. It's a part of our spiritual growth. It's a shedding of the outer cell. In the passing away of the body, the soul moves forward, free from limitation, more fully able to expand into its full potential, in the words of Eric Butterworth. So it's a letting go and an embracing of something greater. So that's great for us, but what about when we do make that transition? What about those who are left behind? We've all been there. We've all lost loved ones, parents, family, whatever, jobs even, relationships, homes. We've all had those times of transition, those times of grief. And you're probably sitting there, well, Gordon, that's all well and good what you're saying, but I am not going to rejoice when a loved one dies. Of course not. You know, one of the things we forget sometimes in Unity, we get into this consciousness of, I am a spiritual being. Everything is wonderful. We forget that we are also human beings. You know, we say we're spiritual beings having a human experience, and that human experience is being human, human beings. And it's important that we not just shove that aside. That is part of what we're here doing. So in as much as we can know truth intellectually or even spiritually, it would be unnatural for us not to grieve when we have a loss. In fact, I would say if you're not grieving when you have a loss, we need to talk. Grief is felt when there's any significant loss. But for our purposes today, we're going to focus on grief when we lose a loved one. Unity offers solace in the understanding that love transcends that transition. Relationships and love are eternal, and the communication with a loved one is still possible through prayer and meditation. It may not be that conscious, direct communication, but there's that energetic connection of love that transcends time and space. Myrtle Fillmore said, "Love cannot die. It is of God, and it is God, and it is forever. It draws us together in the oneness of spirit. It continues no matter what we are doing." Martha Smock echoed that when she wrote, "Those we love are with us always. There is no separation in spirit." And knowing this helps, but we still feel that grief. What do we do with that? Well, we listen to the words of the great teachers. They all said essentially the same thing. We're most familiar in this room with what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount. "Blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted." What was he saying there? He was saying it is appropriate to mourn. By all means, mourn. It's healthy. It's the process we go through whenever we lose someone. And we go through it when we lose other things in life as well. We can mourn for personal loss. We can mourn when there is injustice, when there is suffering in the world. And what that does, it engages our spirit. It engages our heart, and it opens the heart so that we can receive healing and comfort. Mourning implies a deep empathy. It implies a deep love. It implies a recognition of hardships, whether they are personal or collective. And in these moments of vulnerability, we are most receptive to God's presence, to God's grace, and to God's peace. The comfort that is promised is not only or merely a relief from pain, but a deep spiritual solace that comes from knowing that God is present even in our moments of suffering. We could say, and it would be entirely true, that mourning leads to transformation. It allows us to have emotional release. It allows us to grow spiritually, and it nurtures compassion. And through this process, the mourner becomes more aligned with divine love and the awareness of the eternal nature of life. And that transcends suffering. The beatitude that Jesus shared with us reflects a broader principle of spiritual evolution, that moments of sorrow can lead to profound healing, can lead to deeper connection and greater understanding of life's deeper truths. In the song that Bill sang, the Tim McGraw song, there are the lines that, I don't remember the exact words, Bill, but it was like, I'm speaking in a new way, I'm speaking deeper, I'm speaking with more love, I'm being a new person. And that was when faced with his own potential transition. So it brings us to a greater understanding of life and the deeper truths. Death is not an end. It's a transition into a higher expression of spiritual life. I really think it's healthy that we have holidays like Dies de la Muerte, where we recognize the gifts of the ancestors upon whose shoulders we stand. You know, most human beings only know their ancestors back 2, maybe 3 generations. It's very rare to ever know any ancestors beyond that. We can know of them, but we don't know who they were. We don't know their struggles. We don't know their dreams, their hopes, their triumphs, but it's all contained in our evolutionary DNA. We stand on the shoulders of everyone who went before us. We are the culmination of all of those who have gone before. And so it's important, I believe, that we recognize that and that we celebrate that, because one day we will be the ancestors, which is kind of an awesome thought when you think about it. Wow, I'm going to be an ancestor. I've only been a descendant to this point. But someday I will be an ancestor, and whether they remember me or not, they will carry a part of me forward in this experience while I go on to an even greater experience. When you begin to grasp this, life becomes truly amazing. The entire journey from the beginning of time to eternity, which we are a part of, becomes truly astounding. So we see death as life expanding. And through the writings of people like Charles Fillmore, Myrtle Fillmore, Eric Butterworth, Ella Pomeroy, Martha Smock, and so many others, and certainly the teachings of Jesus and the Buddha and Muhammad and so many others, we are reminded of the eternal nature of the soul, of our ongoing unity with God, and the truth that death is a sacred passage rather than a finality. And with that understanding, with that knowledge, we can engage with life in a much fuller way in this now moment, like Tim McGraw did. And we can learn more about this. And we can experience life to its fullest. And we can then say, you know what? I have the courage to embrace this transition that will come at some point with joy, with grace, and with ease. And I stress with the ease, because we learn how to do that more from our workshop today and the event next Saturday, which I hope you all come to. And that is we're going to have a for those of you who are not aware, preparing for our next journey fair, I guess. Our working title was a death fair, but that, not sure on that title. But we're going to have vendors in here. It's open to the entire city. I know I saw it in the journal. And, you know, this is a big event, and it's actually a week-long event that's kicking off next Saturday. I think it's Saturday it kicks off. Actually, it kind of kicks off today with this, huh? And it's citywide. There's going to be murder mystery dinners, and my favorite one that hopefully I'll get to attend is Brewmeisters and Undertakers. That just sounds like fun. But we're going to learn how to move through this process and how to make it easy for those who, around us in our workshops. And most of all, though, between everything we do in the next couple weeks, including celebrating Halloween and Dia de la Muerta, the fair that's coming up, the workshop this afternoon, most of all, we will learn more fully how to always look on the bright side of life. Namaste.
Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Maybe you've been feeling kind of stressed. When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life. for life can be absurd, and death's the final word. At least that's what we've nearly all been taught. Forget about your sin, just pray and go within, for life can change with just a single thought. Always look on the bright side of death. Even as you draw your terminal breath. For life can be absurd, and death is just a word. It all depends on what you think is true. For some say life is tragic, others say it's magic. Remember, in the end, it's up to you. Everybody, always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life. Side of life. Side of life. Side of life.
Walking in the light of God. You are walking, 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 walking in the light of God.
Is it on? Hello? Oh, it's on, yay! I didn't figure that out. Hi, Unity family, how are you?
Wonderful!
Woo! All right. We have some people who want to share. Who would like to share?
So today we... So we listened to this, she read this, like, monster story, and then we were, like, feeling in the bag and guessing what it was at the end, and it was, like, grapes and for, like, eyeballs and stuff, and, like, spaghetti for worms, and it was very fun. And then we're making, right now, still in the process of art, of, like, decorations.
Does anyone else want to share? Anyone?
So today we were planning our Halloween carnival, which is next week. We have a lot of games, and it's sounding really fun. And if you have any, like, kind of like nephews, nieces, grandkids who you think would, like, have fun, it's going to be really fun. Yeah.
Yay.
Okay, guys.
We're also going to have trunk or treat. In case you don't know what that is, basically you trick-or-treat, except instead of going to people's houses, you go to wonderfully decorated trunks of cars. And there's lots of different stuff you can do with your trunks, and it's always a lot of fun. When's trick-or-treat?
So that's all. Okay, thank you, Saya. So that's also next week. So next week is a big all Halloween fun time here. So we're doing the Halloween carnival that the teenagers have been planning, and then service ends. There's a little bit of a break so everyone can get their snacks and everything. And then from 12 to 1:30, we are doing a trunk or treat in our parking lot. And if anyone wants to volunteer, we still have room for more cars to sign up. It's super fun. And so, yeah, we will do that from 12 to 1:30 next week after service. So, yeah, lots of fun next week. And if you have any questions, just contact me. So, yeah, thank you. So can everyone, anyone else want to share? I didn't miss anyone, right? We're good. Okay, so can you guys help me bless these wonderful children?
Children, you are a perfect child of God, and God and I love you just the way you are.
And wear your costumes next week, everybody, okay? Yeah. We're having a costume contest. There's going to be prizes. We're having games. There's going to be prizes. Candy, prizes. Lots of fun. Prizes and candy. Just a couple.
All right. Before we do our prizes. There we go. And our peace song, just a couple reminders. So for the kids, next week we are closing that side of the west side parking area, the one in front of the church, so that the kids can have a safe place to do trunk or treat without people pulling in and out. So if you normally park there, you have two choices. Choice number one, the preferred choice, is you can be one of the trunk or treat cars. Decorate your car. You do have to get your own candy. And let Barbara know if you're willing to do that. If not, then please park out in the east side of the parking lot so we have a safe area for the kids. Okay? And don't forget, come back in here at 12 o'clock, and we will have our workshop with our death doulas. All right, let's stand, and we'll do our prayer for protection and our peace song. Kids ready? The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is. Woo me!
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as Creator, family all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now,
right now.
With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let